Dear learners, let us discuss this chapter on gravitation. Have you ever thought why a ball thrown upward always comes back to the ground? Or a coin tossed in air falls back on the ground? Since time immemorial, human beings have wondered about this phenomenon. The answer was provided in the 17th century by Sir Isaac Newton. He proposed that the gravitational force is responsible for bodies being attracted to the earth. He also said that it is the same force which keeps the moon in its orbit around the earth and planets bound to the sun. It is a universal force, that is, it is present everywhere in the universe. In fact, it is this force that keeps the whole universe together. In this lesson, you will learn Newton's law of gravitation. We shall also study the acceleration caused in objects due to the pull of the earth. This acceleration, called acceleration due to gravity, is not constant on the earth. You will learn the factors due to which it varies. After completing this lesson, you will be able to state the law of gravitation, calculate the value of acceleration due to gravity of a heavenly body. You will be able to analyze the variation in the value of the acceleration due to gravity with height, with depth, and with latitude. It is said that Newton was sitting under a tree when an apple fell on the ground. This set him thinking, since all apples and other objects fall to the ground, there must be some force from the earth acting on them. He asked himself, could it be the same force which keeps the moon in its orbit around the earth? Newton argued that at every point in its orbit, the moon would have flown along a tangent, but is held back to the orbit by some force. Could this continuous fall be due to the same force which forces apple to fall to the ground? He had deduced from Kepler's laws that the force between the sun and planets varies as 1 by r square. Using this result, he was able to show that it is the same force that keeps the moon in its orbit around the earth. Then he generalized the idea to formulate the universal law of gravitation. So, what is universal law of gravitation? It is also known as Newton's law of gravitation. And this law states that every particle attracts every other particle in the universe with a force which varies as the product of their masses and inversely as the square of the distance between them. Suppose we are taking two particles m1 and m2 and the distance between them is r. So now we can write f is proportional to m1 into m2 and f is inversely proportional to r square. So we can write f is proportional to m1 m2 divided by r square. So f is equal to, here we will multiply a constant of proportionality. Here we are taking g as the constant of proportionality. So we can write f is equal to g m1 m2 divided by r square, where g is called the universal constant of gravitation. Later on we will read more about g. Now what is the characteristic of this gravitational force? The gravitational force is always attractive, unlike the force of electricity or magnetic force, because electric force or magnetic force are both attractive and repulsive, but gravitational force is always attractive. It is one of the fundamental force, and the attraction is always mutual. That means if there are two particles, then each particle will attract the other particle. And the force acts along the line joining the two particles. As you know, force is a vector quantity, hence it has magnitude and a direction. Hence, the direction of the gravitational force between two particles acts along the line joining the two particles. Now, what is the vector form of law of gravitation? As I have told, force is a vector quantity, so we can represent this expression F equal to gm1 m2 divided by r square in vector form. Suppose we are taking two particles having masses m1 and m2, and r is the distance between them. Suppose F12 is the force of attraction exerted by m1 on m2. You can see in the figure the force acting on m2 is F12 due to m1, and F21 is the force acting on m1 due to m2. So we can write F12 equal to g m1 m2 divided by r12 square into r12 cap. Here r12 cap is the unit vector. Similarly, we can write F21, that is the force acting on m1 due to m2, is equal to g m1 m2 divided by r21 square into r21 cap. As the unit vector r12 cap and r21 cap are in opposite direction, hence r12 cap equal to minus of r21 cap. So we can write F12 equal to minus of F21. Hence, we can say F12 and F21 are equal and opposite. Here you can see in the mathematical expression that F12 equal to minus of F21, that means their magnitude are same, and the negative sign denotes that the direction are opposite. Here we can say that the force F12 and F21, as they are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction, they form a pair of forces of action and reaction that you have studied earlier in the Newton's third law. Earlier, we have seen that the force of gravitation is equal to F, that is equal to g m1 m2 by r square, where g is the constant of proportionality or universal gravitational constant. But now, what is g, the universal gravitational constant? Actually, the value of constant g is so small that it could not be determined by Newton or his contemporary experimentalists. It was determined by Cavendish for the first time about 100 years later. As you can see, the value of g is very small, 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11. Hence, the value of g is very small, and it is because of the smallness of g that the gravitational force due to ordinary objects that like you and your friend is not felt by us. You cannot feel the gravitational force exerted by your friend on you, or your friend cannot feel the gravitational force exerted by you on him. Now, let us discuss acceleration due to gravity. As we have studied in the Newton's law of motion chapter, that Newton's second law states that force equal to mass into acceleration. Similarly, the force of gravity, the gravitational force is also a force, hence it will also produce an acceleration in the body. The acceleration produced by the force of gravity is known as acceleration due to gravity. And this acceleration due to gravity is denoted by the symbol small g. Now, how can we find out the value of g, or what is the mathematical expression for g? Let us find out. As you know, magnitude of force of gravity on a particle of mass m on the earth's surface is equal to force is equal to F that is equal to g small m. Small m is the mass of particle, capital M, where capital M is the mass of earth, divided by r square, where r is the distance between center of earth and the particle. And as you know, the particle is on the surface of earth. That means this distance will be the radius of the earth. Hence, r is radius of earth here. The force on any particle is equal to mass into acceleration, and here we will take the acceleration as acceleration due to gravity, that is small g. So we can write in place of force m into g, small g. So mg equal to g small m into capital M divided by r square. Now m and m will cancel out, hence g equal to capital G capital M divided by r square. And this is the expression for small g, that is acceleration due to gravity. Now here in this expression you know the value of capital G, that is 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11. Mass of earth is also known to us and radius of earth is also known. That means you can find out the value of small g by putting all these values. And it has been calculated to be 9.8 meter per second square on earth surface. As we have derived the expression for acceleration due to gravity, that is g is equal to capital G capital M divided by r square. Here you can see that in this expression the acceleration due to gravity is independent of the mass of the particle or mass of the body. The small m is not there in the expression. That means acceleration due to gravity is independent of the mass of any particle. It is constant for all particles on the earth surface. If you are dropping a heavy ball and a light ball simultaneously from the same height, then what will happen? You can see that they will fall with the same velocity and also they will reach the ground simultaneously. Under the influence of gravity, a body falls vertically downward towards the earth. For small heights above the surface of the earth, the acceleration due to gravity does not change much. The equation of motion when a body is moving under the force of gravity will be modified as v equal to u plus gt. You have earlier seen that the equation of motion in case of straight line motion, v equal to u plus at. Here you have to replace only g in place of a. So the equation will be v equal to u plus gt, s equal to ut plus half gt square, and v square equal to u square plus 2gs. These are the equation of motion when a body is moving under the force of gravity. And when a body moves under the force of gravity and its acceleration is equal to g, it is said that the body is in free fall. You must be wondering as to why we take radius of the earth as the distance between the earth and a particle on its surface while calculating the force of gravity on that particle. When we consider two discrete particles or mass points, the separation between them is just the distance between them. But when we calculate gravitational force between extended bodies like planets, sun, moon, etc., what distance do we take into account? To resolve this problem, the concept of center of gravity of a body is introduced. This is a point such that as far as the gravitational effect is concerned, we may replace the whole body by just the point and the effect would be the same. For geometrically regular bodies of uniform density such as spheres, cylinders, rectangles, the geometrical center is also the center of gravity. That is why we choose the center of the earth to measure distances to other bodies. Now, let us discuss the variation in the value of g. As we have studied that the value of capital G, that is the universal gravitational constant, does not change anywhere in the universe. But the value of small g, that is the value of acceleration due to gravity, changes with height, with depth and with latitude. Let us first discuss what is the variation of g with height. For large value of h, the magnitude of g decreases as square of the distance from the center of the earth increases. For example, if a particle is situated at a distance r, that is equal to the radius of the earth from the earth's surface, that means the distance of the particle from the center of the earth is the radius of earth plus the distance r above the earth's surface. That means the total distance from the center of earth is 2r, r plus r, that is 2r. That means the value of distance from the earth's surface here is very large, that is almost equal to the radius of earth. In that case, we can find out the acceleration due to gravity g by putting the same formula or same mathematical expression what we have studied earlier, that is small g equal to capital G capital M divided by r square. So the expression becomes g prime divided by g, where g prime is the value of acceleration due to gravity at the point or at a distance r from the earth surface, and g is the acceleration due to gravity on the earth surface. So g prime divided by g equal to r square divided by r prime square. R prime is the distance of the particle from the center of earth. So what is that distance? R prime equal to 2r. So r prime square equal to 4r square. So g prime divided by g is equal to, we can write r square divided by 4r square. R square and r square cancel out and that becomes 1 divided by 4. That means the value of acceleration due to gravity will be 1/4 when the distance is twice of r from the center of earth. But if the distance of particle is less as compared to the radius of earth, then what happens? Let us see. When the distance is smaller, that means s is very much less than r, here you can see in the figure the value h. H is the distance of the particle above the earth surface and r is the radius of earth. Then we can write gh, that is the value of acceleration due to gravity at a distance h from the earth's surface. Gh equal to gm, capital G capital M, divided by r square, and that r square is here the distance from the center of earth to the particle is r plus h. So r plus h whole square, that will become gm divided by r square into 1 plus h by r whole square. And if you simplify, it becomes g divided by gm by r square equal to small g, that will become g divided by 1 plus h by r whole square. Now you can write g divided by gh equal to 1 plus h by r whole square, which is equal to 1 plus 2h by r plus h by r whole square. Here you put the formula a plus b whole square, which is equal to a square plus b square plus 2ab. So this becomes 1 plus 2h by r plus h by r whole square. H, you know that the value of h is very small as compared to r. Hence h by r whole square will be very much less than h by r. Since h by r whole square is very small, it is neglected. Now gh becomes gh equal to g divided by 1 plus 2h by r. Here we have neglected the quantity h by r whole square. So this is the value of g when the distance of the particle is very small as compared to the radius of earth. Now what is the variation of g at a depth from the earth surface? For that, consider a particle at point P at a depth d inside the earth surface. Let us assume that the Earth is a sphere of uniform density. The distance of the point P from the center of the Earth is r, that is small r, is equal to capital R, that is the radius of Earth, minus d, because the particle is at depth d. So d is the depth from the Earth's surface, small r equal to r minus d, capital R is radius of Earth. So this is equal to distance of the point P from the center of Earth, and rho is the density of Earth, which is uniform. Place a mass at point P and it will experience gravitational force due to two types of masses, that is, one for the masses of the cell of thickness d and for masses of the sphere of radius r. It can be shown that the forces due to all the particles in the cell cancel each other. That is, the net force on the particle at P due to the matter in the cell is zero. Therefore, in calculating the acceleration due to gravity at P, we have to consider only the mass of the sphere of radius r minus d. Suppose m prime is the mass of the sphere of radius r minus d. We can write mass equal to volume into density, and density is rho, volume equal to volume of sphere is 4 pi by 3 r cube. So we can write m prime equal to 4 pi by 3 rho. Here radius is r minus d, hence r minus d whole cube. Now the acceleration due to gravity experienced by the particle at point P is gd. Suppose the expression is gd is equal to capital G m prime divided by r minus d whole square. That is equal to, as you know the value of m prime equal to 4 pi by 3 rho r minus d whole cube. Put this value here in m prime and the value of gd becomes 4 pi g, that is capital G, divided by 3 rho into r minus d. Here you see that the value of gd is directly proportional to d, and if d increases, r minus d decreases, the value of r is constant, that is radius of Earth is constant. So if d increases, that means if you go deeper inside the Earth, then the value of r minus d will decrease, and the value of g decreases as we go below the Earth, because g is directly proportional to r minus d. As r minus d decreases when d increases, hence value of g also decreases. If we put d equal to r, that means if we are at the center of the Earth, then put d equal to r in the expression for gd, then it will become r minus r, hence the value of gd will be equal to 0. That means at the center of Earth, the acceleration due to gravity will vanish. It will be equal to 0. Also note that r minus d equal to small r is the distance from the center of Earth, and acceleration due to gravity is linearly proportional to this value, that is small r. Now gd at the surface, that is on the Earth's surface, will be equal to g. Here on the Earth surface the depth is 0, that is small d equal to 0. If we put this value of d in the equation for gd, the value becomes 4 pi g divided by 3 rho into r. This is the value of g at the Earth surface, which is equal to 9.8 meter per second square. Now let us compare the value of g at the surface of Earth and at a depth d. Gd, that is the value of acceleration due to gravity at a depth d, is equal to small g, that is value of acceleration due to gravity at the Earth's surface, into r minus d divided by r. Hence this becomes g into 1 minus d by r, and this is the value when the value of d lies between 0 to r, that is radius of Earth. Here you can see that g decreases with both height as well as depth. We have seen that in case of variation of g with height, height, it decreases as 1 by r square. Here, it decreases as 1 by r. Now, let us represent this variation of g graphically. Here, you can see the graph on your screen that the value of g at exactly r, that is on the earth surface, and the value of g is 9.8 meter per second square. As we go deeper inside the earth, that means the value of r or distance decreases. Hence, you can see the acceleration due to gravity is decreasing, but it is decreasing linearly. But as distance increases, that is in the range from r to 2r, you can see that the value of g also decreasing, but it is decreasing in a curved manner. You know that the earth rotates about its axis. Due to this, every particle on the earth's surface executes circular motion. In the absence of gravity, all these particles would be flying up the earth along the tangents to the circular orbits. Gravity plays an important role in keeping us tied to the earth's surface. You also know that to keep a particle in circular motion, it must be supplied centripetal force. A small part of the gravitational force is used in supplying this centripetal force. So now, how the value of g varies with latitude? The effect of rotation of the earth is maximum at equator and minimum at the poles. So here we will not derive the total mathematical expression, we will only express it in terms of g, omega and lambda, where lambda is the value of latitude at any point. Suppose g lambda is the value of g at latitude lambda, then we can represent g lambda equal to g minus r omega square cos lambda. Here omega is the value of angular velocity of the earth, and r, as you know, it is the radius of earth, lambda is the value of latitude. Hence, we can write or we can find out the value of g, that is acceleration due to gravity, at the poles and at equator. At poles, lambda equal to 90 degree. If you put this value in the equation for g lambda, then cos 90 degree equal to 0. Hence, it becomes g lambda equal to g. That means the value of acceleration due to gravity at the poles is equal to the value of g at the earth surface, that is 9.8 meter per second square. But at the equator, the value of lambda equal to 0 degree. You can put this value and you can get the value of acceleration due to gravity at equator also. So this is all about the variation of g due to height, due to depth and due to latitude. Now let us summarize what we have discussed today. The force of gravitation exists between any two particles in the universe. It varies directly as the product of their masses and inversely as the square of distance between them. The constant of gravitation, that is g, is a universal gravitational constant, and the force of gravitation of earth attracts all bodies towards it. That means the force of gravitation is always attractive. The acceleration due to gravity near the surface of the earth is 9.8 meter per second square, and it varies on the surface of earth because the shape of the earth is not perfectly spherical. The acceleration due to gravity varies with height, depth and latitude that you have seen, and the mathematical expression for this all we have derived also. I hope you have understood what we have discussed today. Thank you.